Good morning. The Lord is good and faithful, and we're here to celebrate His faithfulness. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, we do thank You that You are good, that Your mercy endures forever. We praise You because You've been faithful to us. You've answered our prayers. You have been that friend that sticks closer than a brother to us. And Lord, I pray that our worship would reflect Your goodness and kindness to us today. May everything we do in this service give honor and glory to Christ. We are absolutely dependent upon You. And we pray that Your Spirit now would enable us to worship You in spirit and in truth. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning to everyone. I always have to have everything written down. I've got my songs, and on the back side of it, I had my grocery list. So it's either meat and taters, or it's Revive Us Again. So let's try Revive Us Again. What a wonderful song to open our service today. Pretty good, but I think we can do better, don't you? What, we're right here in the Lord's house, and He's been so good to us. So sing if you can, and if you can't sing, smile. And smile and sing if you can do both. So let's sing verse 2. We praise Thee, O God, for Thy Spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Revive us again. Good. Revive us again. It was slain. John gets his pay docked. He knows I always sing just 3 verses, and he put 4 in. But on this song, that's good, so let's sing the last one. Revive us again, fill each heart with Thy love. May so be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thine the glory. Revive us again. Now we're going to sing Billy Milam's favorite song. Loved him. Thank the Lord for his life. And when we'd sing this, he'd just smile. We'll sing I'm Free. Of the past, for I prayed in my praise the Lord, free at last. I'm free from the guilt that I carried, from the dull, empty life I'm set free. For when I met Jesus, He made me complete. He forgot the foolish man I used to be. I'm free from the fear of tomorrow. Here's the best part. I'm free from the guilt.
This is the reading of God's Word from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 36 through 41. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." With many other words, he warned them, and he pleaded with them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. And may God bless the reading of his word. Amen.
If you will stand with me now as we sing Trust and Obey.
Good morning again. I invite you to take your Bible if you want to turn to Romans chapter 6. the book of Romans chapter 6. Thank you, Timmy. Find my spot. Here we go. This morning, I want to talk to you, if I can make this thing work. I want to talk about baptism today. And one of the reasons I want to talk about baptism is because we've had several people, this is always a great thing to happen, but we've had several people recently express interest in being baptized. And so, Lord willing, maybe over into the month of May, I'm hoping we can have a big day of baptisms. So what I want to do today is to talk about baptism, and I've got in mind kind of three different types of people that are here today, or three categories of people. So, for example, there could be somebody here that fits the category, you've never accepted Jesus. I hope everyone here has, but it could be that you're here and you're not a Christian. So as I talk today about baptism and what it actually means, our prayer would, of course, be for you that you would accept Jesus and trust in Him and then follow the Lord in baptism. So I've got that kind of person in mind. I've also got a person in mind that maybe has accepted Christ. You know you're a Christian, but for various reasons, you've never followed the Lord in baptism. You haven't been baptized as a Christian. And so obviously today as I'm talking about this, one of my goals is to convince you to commit yourself to following through and being baptized as a believer. And then the final category or type of person would be probably the majority here that have accepted Jesus and you've been baptized as a believer. And this is always good for us, even if you've been baptized, don't check out on me here mentally, but stay with me because it's good for us to refresh our minds and our hearts on what we did when we were baptized, what it means for our lives today, and we can better talk to other people about this subject of baptism. All right, so that's what I want to do today. Now, I've got some pictures that I pulled up off the good old internet, and, I don't know where these took place, but these are pictures, obviously, of people that are being baptized. I like the first picture in the top left-hand corner. I don't know the story behind it, but I like to think maybe that the guy who's assisting, the guy that looks like the pastor, that maybe this guy was responsible for bringing this person to faith in Christ. But anyway, you got two guys in the water. The other two pictures, the pastors are cheating. Because, you know, one guy, this may be Cheatham County because if you can't see the top right-hand corner, it's waiters and they're camouflage waiters. So it's cheating. He's not really in the water, so to speak. And then the bottom picture is totally cheating as a pastor. He's outside the water entirely. Now, I'm halfway kidding about that. They're not getting wet. But we've all probably been to and witnessed a number of baptisms in our lives. So I suspect everybody here has seen at least one. Maybe you've seen dozens. And if you've been a Christian for a long time, hopefully you've seen people, maybe in the hundreds of people baptized over the course of time. Now, I want to tell a story along these lines, and some of you will remember the story. I think I've told it to the church before. In my the first church I pastored was my home church, and I was a young pastor at the time. There was a guy in the church that had been, he had been a Christian for a long time. He was now in his late 70s, and he'd been putting off baptism for years, and he finally committed to doing it. And so he was a tall man, again, late 70s, and so I had him in the baptismal waters, and I took him down, not WWE style. I tried to be a little bit ginger with him as I took him down, and I brought him back up, and the whole congregation, and so if this was happening here, of course, all of you would be applauding. You're celebrating. But I had a guy that assisted me with baptisms. He was off to my right, and he had always helped people out, handed them a towel and so forth. And my assistant that day, as I brought this man up out of the water, had the most serious look on his face ever. And so as the congregation was applauding, my assistant said, he didn't go all the way under. I didn't know any better as a young pastor, and I said, okay, that's a premature celebration. I got to take him down again. And so, yes, as a young pastor, I baptized him again on the spot. And so he got a two-for-one deal that day. But we've all seen baptisms over and over again. But I want to ask the question, first of all, okay, what does it actually mean? What does baptism mean? Even if you've witnessed baptisms, hopefully not many like that, Even if you've been baptized yourself, what does it actually mean? We see the act, we see the ritual, but what is the significance of it? So, it comes from the word baptized we have in our English Bibles, comes from a Greek word, baptizo, and you can see how that transliterates over into English. And it literally means to dip or to immerse, or you might even say to plunge. And that's going to be significant for us as Free Will Baptists. We believe, as I'll point out later, that we believe that immersion into the water is the correct mode of baptism. There are other denominations that sprinkle, and we call those people brothers and sisters, but we believe as Free Will Baptists, because of the meaning of the word and what we see in the New Testament, that immersion into the water, because of the meaning of the word, is the correct mode. Now, to kind of follow through on that, you think, for example, in John chapter 3, we read about John the Baptist baptizing a lot of people. In John chapter 3, it talks about a place called Anon, and that he baptized because there was plenty of water there. This isn't rocket science, by the way. There's a lot of water there because in order to immerse or to plunge people, to dip them into the water, you need quite a bit of water. Another significant thing is when Jesus was baptized. Now, I'll say this a couple of times. We are baptized because we are saying we have repented of our sins and we've trusted in Jesus. With the baptism of Jesus, there was nothing for Jesus to repent of. He had no sin in his life. What Jesus is doing in the Gospels when he submits himself to baptism is he's following the plan of God. He's showing solidarity with his people. There was nothing for him to be cleansed from that his baptism was represent. He's simply following the plan of God, submitting himself to John's baptism. But the point here is that Jesus, it says, when he came up out of the water, and so he was immersed or plunged or dipped into the water, submerged, and then brought up by John the Baptist. Imagine that. You're the person, you're John the Baptist, that baptized Jesus. That's remarkable, isn't it? And then the final thing along these lines, we think about the meaning of baptism. You know, the word itself means to dip or to immerse. When you think about the symbolism that's involved with baptism, Romans chapter 6, which we'll read a little bit later in my talk here, Romans chapter 6 talks about how symbolic this act is. That we think about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, and we've just talked about that a lot recently with Easter and, you know, Good Friday and Easter, that Jesus died for our sins on the cross, that he was buried in another man's tomb, and on the third day God raised him from the dead. And so baptism is a visual, moving picture of that event. And so it signifies that I too have been united to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus because of my faith in him. A lot of pastors over the years have said something like this, that baptism, the meaning of it, is it's an outward, visible sign, an outward visible symbol of an inward spiritual change. It says that I've been changed on the inside because I now know Jesus. That just as he died and was buried and was raised from the dead, that I've been raised spiritually. That the old Barry has died and that a new one has come because of the presence of Christ in my life. So that's the meaning of baptism. Knock this over here. Now, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission, that we are to go into all the world and make disciples, that all authority is given to us as his followers, and that we are to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that he has commanded us. And he promises, as we do this, he is with us always, even to the end of the age. Now, the most important thing in this passage is make disciples. That's the controlling idea, that as the church, this is our mission, is to make disciples, to see other people come to follow Jesus, to see people accept Christ. That's the starting point, and then for a lifetime, they follow after Christ. So we hear the word disciple. We don't just need to think about those early disciples. I believe being a Christian is synonymous with being a disciple. You can't be a Christian and not be a disciple. It's one and the same. But as we read this passage, Jesus talks about making disciples, and part of what's involved in making disciples is when they accept Christ, he says, what should you do? You baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. I'll come back to this again at the end of my talk, but you see here clearly, if you believe that Jesus has all authority, He's got all authority over all things, including your life, including the life of the church, then baptism is not optional. Baptism isn't optional. Sometimes as preachers try to talk about baptism, we're prone to say things like, well, baptism isn't, you've heard maybe somebody say baptism isn't essential to salvation. And what they're trying to get at there is that obviously baptism itself doesn't save, and it doesn't. However, don't be mistaken and think that, okay, it's just an add-on sort of thing. No, Jesus is commanding us to be baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now, who should be baptized? I've already talked about this in several different ways, but obviously baptism is for followers or believers in Jesus. And this is one of the reasons we don't practice, as Free Will Baptists, we don't practice infant baptism. Some other denominations do, and again, we count these people brothers and sisters in Christ, but we believe that baptism is only reserved for people that are consciously able to repent of their sins and place their faith in Jesus, that they're at the age and of the capability where they can understand that they're sinners, and they're in need of Christ, and they consciously turn to Christ and call out to Him and believe the gospel. And then once a person has done that on their own, as an individual, as God works with them, then as a follower of Jesus, as a believer into Christ themselves, then they're a candidate for baptism. So it's for believers. Because what it does is it signifies our initial faith into Jesus. That's what it's saying. That's what, if you will, it's screaming. When a person is taken under the water, hopefully just once, not twice, like my friend, but when they go under the water and they're brought back up by the pastor, it is saying, I've already decided to follow Jesus. Sometimes when I was saved at 14, the first one converted in my family, and then from that point forward, kind of grew up in the church, and I used to hear well-meaning preachers all the time say things like, during the invitation, well, if you've never become a Christian, I want you to step out from where you're standing during the invitation and step out and walk the aisle for Jesus. Walk the aisle for Jesus. How many of you have heard something like that before? Walk the aisle for Jesus. Now, let me be clear. There's nothing wrong with saying that. If I'm back here, way back here, and the preacher gives the invitation and he says, walk the aisle for Jesus, and I publicly for the first time, even though there'd be a lot of fear involved with it, I step out and everybody sees me walking forward. And what the preachers were saying was, that is your public declaration that you're deciding to follow Jesus. Now, on one level, there's nothing wrong with that. But on another level, I want to drive home the point that biblically, the way you say you've decided to follow Jesus is not by walking down an aisle. It is baptism. Because baptism says, biblically, you have committed your entire life to Christ. As I said earlier, baptism says there has been this inward spiritual change that God has done in my life, and that my life entirely belongs to Him. And so, if you've walked down an aisle before, but you've never been baptized, then you need to be baptized. If you signed a commitment card somewhere at a church camp, but you've never been baptized, then publicly, according to the Bible, you haven't professed your faith in Jesus, like the Bible says we should. So just as when we take the Lord's Supper, when we take the bread in hand and the cup in hand, when we do that, this ritual that we do often, when we do that as Christians, that says that we have ongoing fellowship with Jesus. Baptism says, visually, that we've decided to follow Christ. That there's been this inward spiritual change. So it's for believers, and this is what it's telling people that are there to witness it. Now, I've already talked about this, but given the meaning of the word baptism itself, we talked about that briefly, and this is a very quick overview. But given the practice of baptisms in the New Testament, and I encourage you to read through the book of Acts and study those examples of baptisms. There are many of them there. Tim read
one example for us earlier. But given the meaning of the word and the practice of baptism in the New Testament and the symbolic nature of Romans chapter 6, we believe as Free Will Baptists that baptism by immersion is the correct mode of baptism. So we've had over the course of time, even since I've been here, this would be true just almost any Free Will Baptist church, as we've had people come from other denominations that were not baptized by immersion, we would ask them to be baptized by immersion to be a member of a Free Will Baptist church. Anyway, let me move on now and talk about why should I be baptized. If you're here and you fit one of those first two categories that I talked about earlier, you're here and you're not a Christian, you've never accepted Jesus, or if you're a person that has accepted Christ but you've not yet been baptized, why should I be baptized? Let me try to answer that question. I want to answer it first of all by talking about why you shouldn't get baptized. You shouldn't get baptized if it's only a ritual for you. You shouldn't get baptized if it's just something that people do that are religious. For example, let me throw out some other examples. If a person thinks to themselves, well, Christians, I see the offering plates. We used to pass the offering plates. That's a part of worship, by the way. God has blessed us with all that we have, and we're only expressing our thanks and gratitude by giving back a portion of what he's given to us. But if you think to yourself, you know, you're not a Christian, and you think, well, if I give money, then I'm somehow earning points with God through this act. Or going back to what I talked about earlier, the Lord's Supper. If you see other Christians celebrating the Lord's Supper at church, and you see the bread coming by and the grape juice coming by, and you think, well, they're doing it. I see this ritual, and maybe I'm good if I take the Lord's Supper, and this is religion to you, and this is what religious people do. Or it could be even more ritual and religion if you do it out of peer pressure. Right? You see other people, especially young people sometimes, they see other people being baptized and they think, well, if everybody else is getting baptized, I will as well. But it's got to be, if you're going to be baptized, it's got to be because you personally have trusted in Jesus. Have you ever personally trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If you haven't, today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. God loves you so much that he sent Jesus to die for you, his one and only son, to give his life as a sacrifice for yours. On the cross, he took the penalty of all your sins, the sins of the whole world. 3 days later, God raised him from the dead, and now he has commanded all people everywhere to repent, that is to turn away from sin and to trust in Jesus. To recognize that you're a sinner, that you're lost, that you cannot save yourself, and to simply call out in desperation from your heart, Lord, save me. And if you will do that in your own heart, in your own way, God promises whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And so if that's never happened in your life, I would love to talk to you after the service is over. And we can pray right here today, and you can personally accept Jesus as your Savior and Lord. Commit your entire life to him. But that's what baptism is all about, that a person has personally trusted in Jesus. That's what it signifies. Now, the other reason you should be baptized, and now I'm kind of getting over into the category of people here today that maybe you're a Christian, but you've never been baptized, and for different reasons you still haven't followed through. I want to convince you to be baptized because Jesus gave you the example. I've already talked about this earlier. We saw it in Mark's gospel. Jesus was baptized, so what are you waiting for? Right? He had nothing to repent of. He had no sin in his life. We all have sin, and part of what baptism is saying is that we recognize we're sinners and that Christ has dealt with our sin, and now we have new life. And so Jesus gave us this example to follow. He submitted himself publicly to baptism. Why won't you? If you're a Christian and you've never been baptized, if you think it's kind of an optional thing, or you're waiting for some reason and you haven't done it yet. And then the final thing that I've already alluded to many times, look, Jesus commanded this. If you're here and in your heart you've already trusted in Jesus, you've decided to follow him. Maybe you've been a Christian for a long time and you know it. You've got assurance, but you haven't followed him in baptism. This isn't an optional thing. If you want to claim Jesus as Lord, then as his lordship is over your life, he says, I want you to be baptized. I want you to follow me in baptism. Now, sometimes people prolong this or put off baptism for a number of reasons. Let me just mention a couple that seem to be most prominent. Oftentimes people put off baptism, in my experience, because they think, well, I'm not going to get into the baptismal waters until I'm perfect. Now, they would never say it, because we all know we're never going to be perfect in life. There's only been one perfect person, and that's Jesus. But what they are getting at is that they don't feel like they have their life together enough yet. That makes sense? Some of y'all are still with me. They feel like, they look at other people who have been baptized, they look at other people in the church, and they think to themselves, and this is a bad thing to start comparing yourselves, but they think to themselves, well, my life isn't like theirs, therefore I must not be a Christian. Or I'll be baptized after I get a few things cleaned up in my life. But that's not what the Bible says you should do. The Bible says if you personally trust in Jesus and you've called out to him and there's been an inward spiritual change and it's real, then you should be baptized. None of us have our act together entirely, right? We don't wait until we get everything cleaned up and then we become a candidate for baptism. No, if you have personally trusted in Jesus, stop, and you haven't been baptized, stop waiting for the day you're going to be perfect, because that's only going to be in heaven. No perfect people are baptized except for Jesus. Now, another thing that keeps people from being baptized, and I'm almost through, and we're going to read Romans 6, is fear. Sometimes people put off baptism out of fear of being up in front of people. And that's a real thing that you have to deal with. And I don't like being up in front of people myself. But what I've discovered, if you're here and you haven't been baptized out of fear, it makes you tremble thinking about getting up in front of everybody and being baptized, like a public spectacle. Is I would tell you that my experience has been, if there's a fear you have, but then you know there's something you're supposed to do, Jesus wants you to do this, when you step into that and you step toward the thing he wants you to do, in the moment you're stepping toward it, he gives you the grace you need to do it. So you might think to yourself, I don't have the courage, I'm not the kind of person that can get up in front of all these people to testify by being baptized that I'm a Christian. If you'll step toward it, if you'll do it because you know that Jesus wants you to do it, in the moment of it, he'll give you the grace you need to follow through. Does that make sense? So, what I want to happen out of this service today is I want to hear from people. If you've never accepted Jesus, we want to talk to you. I'm here today. Brother Forrest is here. John, Donnie, a lot of people would love to share with you how you can become a Christian. We'll walk you through that. We'll pray with you to receive Christ. If there are people here today that haven't been baptized, but you're a Christian, I want to talk to you after the service is over. We want to set up we've got some people, we're lining up for baptism in the coming weeks, and we want to set up a big day in May and have a lot of people going under. One time, I promise, I won't do it twice. We'll do it one time, we'll do it right one time. But what a great thing it is when we're baptized. What a great day that is. This is what Romans chapter 6 says. Romans chapter 6 says, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. What a picture. That we're raised out of those baptismal waters to walk in newness of life. I was converted on a Wednesday night, saved on a Wednesday night in 1989, and the very following Sunday, on Sunday night, I was baptized. Right after church was over, in my hometown, we were riding around, kicking a loop, as we would say back in those days. How embarrassing to say now. But anyway, So I was riding with my best friend. I'd just been baptized, and I remember seeing another guy, another teenager in town, and I said, "I was baptized tonight." And the other guy, he said, "Yeah, I've been baptized too, but it won't last." I'm here today to tell you it has lasted. Not because of me, but because of the grace of God. And the same thing is true in your life. If you've been baptized, if you're considering baptism, the grace of God that saves you is the grace of God that can keep you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time we've had to consider baptism and what it represents. Lord, I do pray that if there's someone here that's never accepted Jesus, that today would be the day of salvation for them. I pray, Father, that if there's someone that's been contemplating baptism as a believer, that they would follow through and commit to doing this great event that will be true in their lives. And I pray for those of us that have accepted Christ and have been baptized, that we would be reminded and refreshed by this truth today, so that we might share the gospel with others this week. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we dismiss, we got a little bit of time before Sunday school starts, so you can enjoy fellowship or come up and talk to me or Brother Forrest or somebody else if you want to follow through what I've talked about today. But Wednesday night classes and everything start back this week, so be in prayer for that. I look forward to seeing you on Wednesday night. Hope you have a good rest of the day. Enjoy this weather. You're dismissed.